Hey, good morning students. Today we are going to start the new pump, and the next kind of pump is a turbomolecular pump. In short, it is also called as TMP, that is turbomolecular pump. And using this kind of pump, you can able to achieve the low pressure or a vacuum up to 10 to the power minus 6 to minus 8 torr. And this turbomolecular pump works on the principle that gas molecules can be given momentum in a desired direction and repeated collisions with a moving solid surface. You can observe in the diagram of the turbomolecular pump, it contains of blades, turbine blades more precisely, and it has a various stages. So two kind of turbine pumps are used. One is a blue shaded blades are the turbine pumps, and green shaded or colored blades are called as the stator pumps. It is having a backing pump also and a chamber at the middle. So I can say the turbomolecular pump consists of alternate layers of stators and rotators, which rotates at very high speed, and the speed of the blades rotated or a rotator is 27,000 RPM and above, that is resolutions per minute, or I can say revolutions per minute, not resolution. The blades are mounted at an optimum angle. The angle between the blades is maintained at its optimum value on both stator and rotator. The high speed rotation imparts the momentum to the gas particle up to collision with the rotator. So whatever I have explained with the help of this diagram, the same thing we have covered in the next slide here. So I can say the high speed molecules are now directed towards the exit using a stator disc. These stator blades are also called as a stator disc. These two adjustment blades are often called as stages in the turbomolecular pump. The turbomolecular pump has 6 to 7 stages depending on the level of the vacuum required. These pumps are more efficient in free molecular regime. They are often backed up by mechanical pumps like a rotary pump. The latest development in the turbomolecular pump includes the replacement of oil bearings with dry and non-lubricant bearings. And the last topic I just explained, we can be able to achieve the vacuum by using this kind of pump up to 10 to the power minus 6 to minus 8 torrs. Hope you have understood the turbomolecular pump. For your better understanding of this turbomolecular pump and earlier some pumps, I will give you the link of some other videos in the Google Classroom also, so you can watch those. Even though you are not able to understand whatever in my lectures, you can watch this also so that you can understand that pumps very well. So let's go for the next kind of a pump. It is called as a sorption pump, and using this sorption pump will be able to achieve a low pressure up to 10 to the power minus 3 torr, or a vacuum up to 10 to the power minus 3 torr. And this sorption pumps works at room temperatures also. So in the diagram itself, you can see the sorption pump has a safety valve, it has an inlet, then molecular sieve, wire mesh cylinder, liquid nitrogen into it, and insulation bottles. So this kind of a sorption pumps are physically a simplest form of a pumps available, which provides a convenient and clean backing pump. Convenient and clean backing pump means oil-free pumps for obtaining the high vacuum. So the sorption pump consists of cylindrical container. So this bottle-like structure is nothing but your cylindrical container with a filling of material which has a large surface area and serves gas by Fizeau sorption. Historically, the first such material, we'll go in the next slide. So historically, the first such material was activated by charcoal, but nowadays the custom built activated alumina silicates are used. This alumina silicate is also called as a geolite material, and they are generally known as molecular sieves. The essential feature of the sorption pump material is very high surface area to volume ratio. Thus, activated charcoal prepared with effective surface area around 2500 meter cube per gram. Though these kind of pumps absorb the gases at room temperature, so sorption is greatly increased by cooling to the liquid nitrogen temperature up to 77 Kelvin, and this is a general feature of all sorption pump materials. The molecular sieve material offers a greater sorption capacity at low temperature than activated charcoal and is generally more consistent in its properties. Although it suffers from the fact that its thermal conductivity is considerably less than a charcoal and it is therefore less radially chilled. Molecular sieve materials are provided with a specific pore diameter, and the popular materials are characterized as 4A, 5A and 13A. These are the kind of materials. These numbers nearly categorizes the materials according to their pore diameter in angstrom units. Thus, 5A pore diameter of 5 angstrom has a 5 angstrom. Thus, 5A is the material most commonly used and is calcium alumina silicate, usually supplied as a spherical plate approximately 3 millimeter in diameter. So this is all about the explanation of the sorption pumps and the various kind of materials that you can use in case of this sorption kind of a pumps. So hope you have got this, and it has a single disadvantage. So these materials can't absorb the inert gases like hydrogens and all other inert gases, of course. And therefore, you can't use this kind of a pumps wherever the inert gases are exist. So this is only the disadvantage of using the sorption kind of a pumps. Now let us go ahead for the next kind of a pump called as a cryo pump. There are various kind of a cryo pump, and this cryo pump operates on the principle that gas can be condensed and held at extremely low vapor pressure, achieving high speed and throughputs. So this is a pictorial representation of the cryo pump, which contains the vacuum sphere, the charcoal, the first cold stage, second cold stage, pump case, baffle, and helium entrance, then hydrogen thermometer and refrigerator. And using this kind of pumps, we can achieve a vacuum up to 10 to the power minus 10 to minus 12 torr, or approximately from 10 to the power minus 9 to minus 12 torr. In some books it is given 10 to the power minus 10 to minus 12 torr, and if you can search out various books, you can find it's range from minus 9 to minus 12 torr. So roughly we can say by using these cryo pumps we can obtain a vacuum up to 10 to the power minus 12 to minus 10, or minus 10 to minus 12 torr. So this contains a cold heat drive also. So this cold heat drive is nothing but a refrigerator which has a cold heat. Got it? So let's go ahead and try to understand the working of this cryo pump. So cryo pump depends for its operation on Fizeau sorption of gases on a chilled surface. So the surface must be a chilled, that means cold. And roughly speaking, the temperature of the chilled surfaces determines the ultimate pressure attainable, while the refrigerative power determines the pumping speed. Right? The explanation or the working of this pump of I have already mentioned in the next video. So next slide. So I can go ahead. This is the representation of graphical representation for various gases. And I think before proceeding to the working of this pump, let us try to understand first what is mean by cryopump. So this cryopump is a vacuum pump that traps the gases and vapors by condensing them on a cold surface. For effective evacuation under ultra high vacuum, the vapor pressure for condensation or the equilibrium pressure for absorption must be less than 10 to 8 Pascal. Now whatever I have explained here, that is the explanation of this ABO graphical representation. And in this graphical representation, you can see the various gases. The graphical representation is for various gases like inert gases, helium, hydrogen, neon, and all other gases are reactive gases. That means non-inert gases like nitrogen, carbon dioxide, argon, oxygen, CH4, methane, again carbon dioxide, chlorine, and NH3 and Br2, bromine, and water. So on the x-axis we are having a temperature in Kelvin, and your y-axis contains of vapor pressure. Got it? So the variation of vapor pressure with temperature for different gases when temperature is less than 20 Kelvin, the vapor pressure of the gas other than helium, hydrogen, and neon are close to 10 to the power of how much? Minus 9 millibars. And now this is in Pascal, right? So you need to be a conversion. So all the gases except helium, hydrogen, and neon are frozen at how many Kelvin? So this is frozen around 70 Kelvin and 20 Kelvin. Cold heat gases, helium, hydrogen, and neon are absorbed on the charcoal. Got it? So this is just a representation, a graphical representation for the various gases. And this is what I have explained in this slide only. So you can go through this also. You will come to know this easily. So cryopump depends for its operation on physiosorption of gases on a chilled surfaces. I think this is also I have explained in the diagram of the cryopumps. So I can say the cryopumps on the face of it would appear similar to the sorption pump in relying to the physiosorption on cold surfaces or chilled surfaces for its pumping operation. So the temperature of the operation of the cryopump is always much lower than that of the sorption pump. The vacuuming process involves the condensation of gases onto the cold head, not a cold head, it's a cold head actually. The variation of the equilibrium vapor pressure with temperature of the different gases and temperature is less than 20 Kelvin. This I have just explained on the graph. The vapor pressure of the gases other than helium, hydrogen, and neon are close to 10 to the power minus 9 millibar. Hence, it is clear that the speed is directly proportional to the surface area of the cold head. These pumps are self-controlled hydrocarbon free and cooled by two-stage cryocoolers, I can say, right? So this is about the cryopump. And let's go for the next kind of a pump, that is a sputter ion pump. And this sputter ion pump works on the principle of ionization and the sputtering of the metal, right? And this pump contains plates. That means these plates are having a cathodes. Plates are nothing but the cathodes of a titanium material, and the magnetic field is generated across the plates, or I can say cathode. Fine. So we have a cathode and anode. So these titanium plates are nothing but a cathode. You can see there titanium cathode on two sides. So those are the cathodes, and anode is in between, where the gas is ionized over there, right? Let me explain this more clearly. So in order to use the guttering action in a pump, it is necessary to select the material which has a very high sticking coefficient. Isn't it? And which can be conveniently presented as a high range surface area field. Usually, choice for such material is titanium, although zirconium has been used. So this kind of a pump is used in two forms, diode form and a triode form. So let me finish in diode and triode form also, and then next time we'll go for the next. So diode form is a form in which honeycomb and anode structure is suspended symmetrically between two titanium plates. The diagram itself explains this. So two titanium electrodes. The pump operated by sputtering titanium from titanium cathode in a gas discharge by application of nearly 5 kV between anode and cathode. Uniform magnetic field density is established with its lines along the common axis symmetry of electrode. So within this configuration, the electrons are confined to spiral path having axis along the electrode. So consequently, they do not reach the anode immediately, but oscillates backward and forward between the cathodes in the tight spiral path before finally trapped at the anode. So you can this whole explanation you can visualize with the help of a diagram so that you can better understand this. As a result, the average electron path is very long and its ability to ionize a gas atom is presented. Even down the pressure of 10 to the power minus 10 millibar, the positive ions produced by electron impacts are accelerated through the applied potential and strike the titanium anode. And they are collected and ejected not only titanium atoms, but previously served gas on cathode surface and also electron. Those are called as the secondary electrons. These electrons later joins in the ionization process. So the mass of each positive ion, which is at least 3.7 into 10 to the power 3 times that of an electron, and in consequence they reach the cathode almost directly, and thus I can say the sputtering of titanium from cathode result in fresh active titanium field being positive anode, and thus at the anode most of the gases are chemosorbed and held as a titanium compound. For the inert gases, the situation is different since they can't form the chemical compounds. The inert gases are pumped by converting into ions and accelerated by the electric field to cathode and then buried in the cathode. Now let's go for the advantages of using this kind of a pump, that is a sputter pump. There is no pumping fluid, consequently back striking doesn't occur and cold traps and baffles are not required. The pressure attained by the gas is directly proportional to the discharge current, so that with suitable calibration, the pump current can be used to measure the pressure. The pump speed is roughly constant from 10 to the power minus 5 millibar to minus 8 millibar, and this kind of pumps are having a silent operation and the power consumption is very low. So these are some advantages of using the diode form of a sputter pump. Now, what are the disadvantages of a sputter pump? The pump has a long but finite lifetime, limited by sputtered material, and this is due to short circuiting. Under certain circumstances, inert gases like argon will be released from cathode due to the argon instability. And the third disadvantage is hydrocarbons adversely affect the pump operation, and this pump needs the magnetic field, and without magnetic field you cannot operate this pump. So these are some disadvantages of using this kind of pump. So this sputter pump is also used in other form, that is a triode form, and the diagram in the triode form is a similar like a diode form also. So there is no different explanation for it, but the only difference is that the large collector area available for triode pump means that this pump exhibits a very little memory effect, and thus the increased pumping rate ensures the adequate argon ion buried on it. Fine. So this is all about the sputter ion pump, and next time we'll go for the next and last kind of a pump, that is Arbitron. Hope you have understood this. This is a complete theoretical chapter, and hence I need to explain the diagram, and along with this I will post one more video. If you are having a problem, you can see those videos also. Thank you.